Archaebacteria. And today we are going to talk about Archaebacteria.
Do you know what's Archaebacteria?
First of all, I'll introduce you is Carlos Linnaeus. Carlos Linnaeus is the father of modern taxonomy. He is a Swedish botanist, an explorer who is the first to frame the principles for defining natural genera and species of organisms, and also created a uniform system for naming them, called the binomial nomenclature. As we all know, there were scientists from the past who proposed kingdom systems. There were three, five, and ended up with three domain system and six classification for kingdoms. Three domain system, which was discovered by Carl Weiss in 1977. The three domain system consists of bacteria that has kingdom Eubacteria in it. Archaea, which consists of kingdom Archaebacteria, which is our main topic for today, which will be discussed later. And Eukarya, which consists of four kingdoms consisting of Protista, Fungi, Animalia, and Plantae. Archaebacteria are a type of single-cell organism which are so different from other modern life forms that they have challenged the way scientists classify life.
However, genetic and biological studies of bacteria soon showed that one prokaryote was very different from the modern bacteria. They're called Archaebacteria, Archae from ancient. These unique cells are thought to be a modern descendant of the ancient lineage that evolved around rich deep sea beds.
Sophisticated genetic and biochemical analysis has led to a new phylogenetic tree of life, which makes use of the concept of domains to describe divisions of life that are bigger and more basic than that of the kingdom. Phylogenetics is the study of evolutionary relationships between life forms.
The discovery of archaea and its unique differences is exciting for scientists, because it's believed that Archaebacteria's unique biochemistry might give us insight into the workings of every ancient life. Some scientists propose that Archaebacteria thermoplasma may in fact be ancestors of the nuclei of our own eukaryotic cells, which are believed to have developed through the process of endosymbiosis.
Another remarkable trait of Archaebacteria is their ability to survive in extreme environments, including very salty, very acidic, and very hot surroundings. Archaebacteria have been recorded surviving temperatures as high as 190 degrees Fahrenheit.
Another remarkable trait of Archaebacteria is their ability to survive in extreme environments, including very salty, very acidic, and very hot surroundings. Archaebacteria have been recorded surviving temperatures as high as 190 Fahrenheit, which is only 22 degrees shy of boiling point of water, and acidities as high as 0.9 pH.
Archaebacteria have even challenged scientists' ideas about how to define a species. Since they practice a lot of horizontal gene transfer, where genes are transferred from one individual to another during their lifetimes, making it difficult to determine how closely different cells are related, or even if Archaebacteria cells have the sort of stable combinations of traits that scientists typically use to define a species.
Archaebacteria have a number of characteristics not seen in more modern cell types. This includes unique cell membrane chemistry. Archaebacteria have cell membranes made of either linked phospholipids, while bacteria and eukaryotes both make their cell membranes out of either linked phospholipids. Unique gene transcription. Archaebacteria have a single round chromosome like bacteria, but their gene transcription is similar to that which occurs in the nuclei of eukaryotic cells. This leads to the strange situations that most genes involving most life forms. Such as production of the cell membrane, are more closely shared by the eukarya and bacteria, but genes involved in the process of gene transcription are more closely shared by eukarya and archaea. Only Archaebacteria are capable of methanogenesis, a form of anaerobic respiration that produces methane. Archaebacteria who use other forms of cellular respiration also exist, but methane-producing cells are not found in bacteria or eukarya.
There are three main types of Archaebacteria. These are classified based on their phylogenetic relationship.
Welcome.
first example of archaebacteria based on phylogenetic relationship is Grenarchaeota. They're extremely heat tolerant. They have special proteins and biochemistry that can continue to function at temperatures as high as 230 degrees Fahrenheit. Many Grenarchaeota can also survive in very acidic environments. One theory of the origin of life suggests that life may have originally started around deep sea vents, where high temperatures and unusual chemistries could have led to the formation of the first cells.
Are able to survive in very salty habitats. They are able to produce methane, which no other life forms on Earth is able to do.
Carcharoteota are the least understood and thought to be the oldest lineage of archaebacteria. This makes them possibly the oldest surviving organisms on Earth. Carcharoteota can be found in hydrothermal environments much like Grenarchaeota. However, Carcharoteota may have genes found in both Grenarchaeota and Eurarchaeota, and also genes which are different from both groups. To scientists, this suggests that both other types of archaebacteria may have descended from a common ancestor similar to Carcharoteota. It has a highly unique genome consisting of roughly 26% proteins that are known to be found in other archaebacteria, 29% proteins that are known to be found in bacteria, 32% genes that do not correspond to any known protein, and negative 3.3% genes that are correspond to those only found in eukaryotes. These genes are involved in phagocytosis, which is exciting because the process of phagocytosis could have been used by eukaryotic ancestors to swallow other cells, which may have gone on to become endosymbiotes, leading to the endosymbiotic relationships between eukaryotic cells and their mitochondria, chloroplasts, and nuclei.
Archaebacteria are autotrophs that use carbon dioxide in atmosphere as a source of carbon, for a process called carbon fixation. Archaebacteria are able to survive in extreme conditions and therefore also known as extremophiles. They can survive in conditions that are highly acidic, alkaline, and saline aquatic environment. Some are even able to survive in temperatures above 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Few can even withstand over 200 atmosphere pressure and live really deep within the earth. They employ different chemical reactions to be able to survive in these harsh conditions. They are divided into three subgroups.
Methanogens. Methanogens are able to reduce carbon dioxide into methane. They're obligately anaerobic and can die if exposed to oxygen. They produce marsh gas that can be observed as bubbles in stagnant water. They're also present in the Gulf of Cuttle and termites since there's no oxygen there. Methanogens use carbon dioxide as an electron acceptor to oxidize hydrogen using coenzymes like coenzyme M and methanoferrin. These coenzymes are very unique to archaebacteria. These bacteria are rod shaped or spherical and can be gram positive as well as negative. Halophilus are bacteria that can survive in 10 times the concentration of salt present in sea. You can find halophilic archaebacteria in Great Salt Lake in Utah and the Dead Sea in Middle East. Halobacter uses photophosphorylation for metabolism. They use light-activated ion pumps like bacteriorhodopsin and halorhodopsin for generation of ion gradients to pump out ions across the plasma membrane. The energy that is stored in the electrochemical gradients is converted to ATP by ATP synthase. They contain bacteriorhodopsin, a red or orange pigment. Thermoacidophiles are organisms that can survive in extremely high temperatures and low pH. They can survive in 100 degrees Celsius with a pH of 2. Most of these organisms are anaerobic in nature.
ことでは